Work in the profit.
Yeah. So I'm going to talk about our latest advances in XBL 3, which is, for those who do not know, the foundation of LaTeX 3. It's the programmer's level. So nothing to do with document syntax here. Nothing whatsoever. So we'll start with a bit of history, just to take a look at what the motivation behind this. Well, as we all know, tech is a macro language and a document language. And sometimes this mixture of both worlds is nice, and sometimes when you try to be a programmer, it's less nice. So, Knuth and Lamport came up with a brilliant solution. We'll use the at sign as a secret marker to mark that this is something internal. But there is a small problem with that. All of the primitives in tech do not use at signs, even though many of them should certainly never ever see the document level. And there are many good names that have already been taken. I mean, box is a pretty good name. If you wanted to produce a box or a special, or if you're into linear algebra, you might want to use span as an operator until you figure out that doesn't work in any way. So, and this leads to some, as I say, some typical communications with tech, where users are told that their use of at doesn't match its definition, and they scratch their head, and then they're told they can't use space factor in vertical or math mode. Say what? And they discover they have spurious spaces everywhere, until someone comes along and tells them, oh, you have to use the comment sign at the end of each and every line in your code, which makes the percent character, the fourth most common, commonly input character after backslash, left brace, and right brace.
And space.
Come again?
And space.
Yeah, and space, yeah. And
real tech programmers never use spaces.
And here, Nelson is absolutely correct. We don't use spaces. Yes, in tech you use spaces to delimit numbers in certain cases. If the number is already already terminated, you'll get a spurious space instead. So we thought, why not have a programming environment where all white space is ignored? Because most of the time you don't want it. If you really want the space, you can just type that I want the space. Okay. We've also come up with a consistent naming scheme where you use the module, use the description, and possibly a data type, if it's in fact a data type we're dealing with. We use the underscore to enhance readability. I personally don't like the at sign because it's just one long blob of, if I use the underscore, then I can actually see that this is a constant from the module. I call module, it's a magic constant, and it's an integer. So very simple. We use the colon to put into macros that are in fact what we call functions. A function does something, whereas a parameter or a variable just stores contents. A function does something about it. So we use the colon to signal that it's a function, and then we use an argument signature to tell what to do with this. And in this foobar function, it takes two arguments that are both normal, meaning red and braces. So, in regular LaTeX, we know that we turn on the special at sign with make at a letter, and you can turn it off with make at other. In XBL 3, we go a little further because we do other stuff. So there it's called XBuild syntax on and XBuild syntax off. And instead of, it's a little cleverer than makeOutLetter because it actually records the current status. Except if it's already on, then it doesn't try to copy what's already there and then issue again. So it's some way towards a proper cat code regime for programming and going back to the document syntax. It's also very easy to load all of this because you just use a combining package called XBuild3. So let's jump to an example. Say we've loaded XBuild3 and then we want to create a sequence where we can store stuff, like whenever you enter an environment, you may want to record what environment we're going into, and so you can still look back at what came before it. So we can create a new sequence. This is a global one from my module because I say so, and it's the sequence. And then I can push stuff onto the sequence. It takes two arguments. Capital N is a single token, and lowercase n is, as I said before, an argument in braces. We use G whenever things are done globally. So again, to keep the naming simplistic and intuitive. You can also pop. It's again, you're working on a global stack, so you better use a global pop operation, and then you store whatever you popped in that. And there are many, many functions for this, for stacks and sequences. Also got dex, not added to the repository yet, but it's there, fully functioning, so you can go both ways. And property lists that are immensely useful.
Martin?
Yeah.
This may be jumping ahead, but
yeah.
I see you have seek new and everything else is global.
Yeah.
So what if you did seek new inside a group?
Every new of these kinds are,
it's always
global. Are global. But it's a very good question because I was wondering that when I typed it in and whether someone would ask. So, very good question. I recall Adita talking about expansion. And yes, expansion control is good. It's a good way to teach your kids how to do tables. but the other than that, I mean, it's nice to know that table. We can all do that. But the real problem is when to know where in the table you are. And I have a lovely example a little later. We use the argument signature I mentioned to make this a tad easier. Like if you want to expand something once, you use an O instead of an N. If you want to construct something from a CS name, and then you use the C, and it will make a CS name, and then pass it on to, and this is a typo, it's a capital N, because it's a single token coming out of it. If you want to do full expansion, as in when using an EDEF, you use the X, and it'll do that, and then return it to the base function using the N. So that way, you actually don't have to type expand after very often, if at all. Here's a quick example of using the C. It's the same as before. Here I just construct a CS name first, and then it's passed on to the capital N version, and then I have the same as I did before. I get rid of all this mishmash of interwoven expander after and CS name. It's a lot easier to read what actually goes on, and therefore also a lot easier to maintain. For the X expansion, it's pretty much the same. Here I have a token list, if empty, take one argument, if true, write the words empty, otherwise just input it there. So this will just do it in one go, and we're done. Usually you'd have to, well, if you had a test for if a token listed empty, then you'd have to store it in some temporary control sequence. Then you would have to expand that at the correct moment in time so that it would get put onto this one, which we first had to construct out of this. I'm getting dizzy just talking about it. So we got all that down. What we have done in the last 6 months is doing a lot of renaming, taking a step back, going into the tech book a bit, looking at the BNF to see what was going on. When it came to data types, we had gotten it fairly okay. But when it came to the most common data type in tech, namely control sequences, we had still gone with the old names. So we had def, single token, parameter text, and then replacement text, whenever it was a control sequence. But if we wanted to take a copy of a control sequence, we would use let. But then we looked at the tech book, and it actually just says CS every time it's working with a control sequence. So we thought, well, why don't we do that? And then we get set and set equal. So we have a more consistent naming. It's very simple. Plus, all the data types have the same kind of operations. Either you set it, or you copy it, or you make a new one, or you make a new fresh copy. One other thing we did was a typical complaint, and you can find several instances of this in the LaTeX bugs database, is that argument of something has an extra, or par is not allowed in the argument of XYZ. And the reason is that many parts of the LaTeX kernel were in fact not made long in tech respect. And we decided, well, usually it's up to the document level parser to decide what's, am I allowed to take multiple paragraphs or am I not? So we decided to make almost all of the kernel long, and so the set operation is long in that respect. We hope that this will create fewer problems so that the kernel will accept as much as possible, but the document layer will be the one preventing it happening. Right now you can see a similar problem. If you try to do text boldface, text BF on a paragraph, on two paragraphs, you'll get an error message because of the lower level command not being long. We've done a bit of renaming in what we had was called token list pointers, and we figured out that they're also just plain token lists out there where you often work straight in the input stream, so we removed the P. And we have a simpler naming scheme for using tokens in the input stream. Like you have in LaTeX, you have at first of two or at second of two, or now it's just use and then which ones you want to use. So here I use the second one of a three. If I wanted to use both the first and the second one, I'd just type I_II, and I'll get what I want. This is a very simple way of doing it instead of this. One of the major new things is retrieving the value of a register. If I want to retrieve the value of something stored within a macro, I have to expand the macro once. If I want to retrieve the value of something stored within an integer register, I have to prefix it with the and expand it once, and then I'm happy because I know that the returns the result after exactly one expansion. And this is all good. But what if I instead wanted to provide something that had some error checking, that this was actually an integer that's well formed? Well, then I can't do with one expansion anymore. Then I have to do You know, how many expansions do I have to do? That's the question. I could perhaps do two, but if I knew that this one would return the result in exactly two expansions, perhaps it's more. And so it's nice that we have the argument signature to help us with this, but you still have to count. It's just a different table. Now you have to know which letter to pick up, rather than, and this is not very natural. So I'll have to use different syntax depending on how the register is implemented. If I had a fake integer, it's just a macro storing a number, I would have to use this syntax. But if it was a real integer, I'd have to use this syntax. And that's impossible, or at least very difficult. So we came up with a different solution, which is very simple. Think of what you want rather than how you want it. I just want the value of a register. Fine, I'll use V. That was the difficult part, choosing the correct letter. I just want the value of this integer, of this register. And here I just want the value of it. So this relieves me from having to know how we implemented it, and first and foremost, how many expansions it took to get there. It also provides us with a method for checking for errors for, say, malformed CS names. Like if you have this oops token list that wasn't actually defined, and if I want to input the value of that, then it'll figure out, hey, but this is equal to relax. A token list should not be equal to relax. And this is an error, so I'll throw the error. And this is done in an expandable context, so you actually still get the error, and then it cleans up nicely after itself, and then continues with life. Rather than previous versions where you would just store, either you would store an error message, which you then get later on in the document when the code was actually executed, or you would just get a typeset relax, which can sometimes be pretty difficult to find. We also wanted definitions to be a tad easier. In tech, you always have to use the primitive parameter. And when you get to number 4 or 5, then I start typing it all wrong. But it works, but it's just not most natural for me. In LaTeX, you have new command, and then you enter the number. And that works quite well as well, except you cannot have the limited arguments. But with all the functionality we have built into XPL3, and the fact that most of the really complex stuff happens at the document level, that's where people have strange syntax, we found that we rarely needed the limited arguments at the programmer's level. At the programmer level, most of the stuff is fairly normalized. You have a specific number of arguments. And we said, wait, we already know this, because we use the signature to tell how many arguments we're going to take. If I define one that says n, 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 then I have 1, 2, 3 arguments. So that's all I need to input. I can still tell tech by using the primitive parameter text that I want 1, 2, 3, and then I'll get 1, 2, 3. But for most cases, I don't need to tell it that. It's unnecessary. So I just do it. And it works. The point here is that we want to make, if I already know that a function has 3 arguments, I should not have to tell tech that it has 3 arguments, because I've already told it once. So it should understand that.
Does it do optional?
See,
does
optional.
It do optional arguments?
Not at this level. There are no optional arguments.
Good answer.
Lots and lots in XPARSE at the document level,
yeah,
but
right.
not Not here.
Another case where we've really done a lot of work is conditional processing. We've all tried to do if constructs, but we often found that we read some arguments, then we perform a series of complicated tests, and then we want to figure out, okay, did all these tests return something that was true, or did they return something that was false? Or did things go haywire and we wound up in some error state, like dividing by zero? Who knows, it happens. The idea is for us to first figure out which state are we in, and then we use the state. We can, if you recall seeing the TLFMT function, it had a TF, because it would then test its argument. If true, it would return the T case, the true case, or otherwise it would return the false case. We also have versions that are only working on the true or the false, and then a special one called the predicate function that returns a Boolean true or false, which you can use in logical operations. I'll show those a little later. But how do people do it now? The other day I found that someone had actually uploaded a Boolean expression package to CTAN. I was like, wow, it works by expansion, just like our Boolean expression parser. So, okay, good, I'll be left to see how they do it. Okay, so it's a simple task. Within this one function in particular I took a look at, it's a very simple task. It wants to read a single token. It wants to then do some tests on it, and then it returns either some true code or some false code. In the function in question, the argument is one of these five. If it matches, then we choose the true, otherwise we choose the false. And here is how it's done. As you'll all see, here we have level n, so 2 to the level 1, so 2 to the first minus 1, that's 1. And next level, 2 to the second minus 1, that's 3. And 7, and 15, and 31. So in the first case, it returns the second of the arguments. So does it here, and here, and here, and here. Otherwise, it returns the first of the arguments.
Okay. Oops. Uh-oh. I'm in trouble. I'm not in trouble.
So that's something that will give you a headache right away. But what if I also wanted a version of this that just returned the true value? And if it was false, I wouldn't do anything. I'd just continue on.
And I can either copy it all and change all the first of two and second of two into gobble and first of one. Or I can write another one that uses it and then calls the right ones.
We came up with something that was a tad easier, we felt. I want to make a new conditional. This is the name of the base test. And then I want to create the true false version, and I want to create the true version. And I do my test. And oh, if it was this, I'll return false. Or if it was this, I'll return false. Otherwise, I'll return true. And this works exactly the same. There's no plethora of expand after. And this is a lot simpler to program. This is a lot simpler to maintain. And it also has the bonus that if you forget one of the branches, if it's actually executed, you will get an error message when it's executed. We could also do the F variant or the P variant if we wanted. All the kernel functions have that. Say, but for a specific package, you may not want all four variants because you're the only one who's ever going to use it. If it's an internal command, so you can choose which you like.
Internally, is it still creating 2 to the minus n expand afters, or is it some completely different mechanism that somehow bypasses
it? I think this is about now when I take a detour into ancient history and have to thank the Romans for not using negative numbers or the number 0. This works by using Roman numeral. At the end of this code, we place the number 0, and then we make use of the fact that Roman numeral of 0 is nothing. So you set it off, and it'll expand away looking for some number. And in the meantime, while it's doing that, it'll gladly, oh, there's an else. Oh, no more, no worry. I'm just skipping this. Oh, there's a V. Oh, okay, done with that. So it gets rid of all of those. And once it's done, there's a if true or if false underneath.
Uh-huh.
And that will put tech in its correct state. And that's how we can also make it go for the error cases, because you can then use a case switch. So it's like you get, if it returns 1, then it's true. If it returns 0, it's false. If it returns 2, then it was an error or
mm-hmm.
whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So we got a lot of opportunities this way.
What happens if the argument is itself a conditional? This is great.
If a conditional is defined with this interface, then it'll all work by, I mean, you can nest them as much as you like. If I understand your question correctly.
The magic of this first argument signature, it knows how to expand everything.
Then it'll know, okay, if I'm doing the true F version, then I know what to do when it's done, when I've called this function, then it does all of this and with the argument, and then it'll know, then it'll be in a state. Then it'll be in a true state or in a false state. So, I don't know if it answers your question. But it works. You can nest and so on and so forth. So
I suppose that if you said new if foo and passed if foo to this, it would not work. It has to be a LaTeX 3 thing that you're passing in here. You can't just pass an arbitrary thing you define yourself in our usual ways.
Oh, well, anything that ends with a... See, it's meant for this kind of primitive conditional formatting.
Uh-huh.
But even then, it doesn't actually have to have any left here, because it's not dependent on being inside a primitive if branch. You could might as well have something else, and then it'll still use return false, return true, because all these two commands are concerned about is that magic number waiting for it, and then what it's supposed to do after it found the magic number. And as we said before, numbers are tricky. Sometimes you get spurious spaces, sometimes you don't, because tech used the space to read it, and that makes you insert relax all the place, because Don said it was good, and it doesn't do anything, except if you're working in an expandable context, because then relax is pretty unexpandable. That's the idea. So they may be left behind. So in comes eTech that has a wonderful little thing called the num expression and dim expression and so on. And it'll gobble a relax for you if it finds one. That's an immensely useful feature. So we can write something here where you don't have to bother with relax or anything. However, this is not really natural. I mean, I'm not going to teach my kids to do number comparison this way. I'd much rather do something very simple. And then we thought, oh, okay. Then let's also support some other natural syntaxes, like less than or equal, instead of the user having to reverse the logic all the time. And once again, the magic macro, the magic command to implement this is Roman numeral. Because it has the effect, if it's hit with a negative number, it'll expand to nothing. So that's, you can calculate this number first, and then if it's negative, you'll just do Roman numeral on it, and then it disappears, and then you get to the relation, and then you can figure out what to do. But the most important part here is that it allows a natural syntax, not something where you have to be aware of strange rules within tech. You don't have to worry too much about the grace groups. You just write what you need to write. Same can be said through Boolean expressions. I'm used to Boolean expressions using double ampersand for and or and not and parentheses for grouping. So why shouldn't I be able to do that? And I can. So I can write my, oh, first I want to compare 1 equals 1, and I want to compare it with this group, where I test. But here, I already figured out, oh, 4 does equal 4, so I don't have to test this last one. So it does lazy evaluation. Unlike the if-then package or many other things that actually process everything, this will happily skip the error cases, which is usually what you want. And it supports negation and so on. So this one will return the truth value also as a Boolean. No cat code tricks or anything. In fact, this was, I thought, was a very nice way to catch people doing cat code tricks. Because if they start doing funny things with this or with this in places where they shouldn't, meaning outside the document layer, then they will probably get notified somehow. All parts of XBOL 3 have undergone revision. In large part thanks to Joseph Wright and Will Robertson, who are new on the LaTeX team roster, because they've asked questions, why is this this, why is this that? And we had to come up with good answers. Sometimes we came up with a very good answer. Sometimes we had to think about it some more. And it led to many good extensions, many good changes. We don't expect to make big changes to what we have now. This was sort of the, yeah, now we've gone through it once and for all. We will extend it, but most of the forthcoming work will be on higher level packages. We have XParse that does the document level. We have Template that does the medium intermediate level. Joseph is using XBOL 3 for his own stuff now. I'll be porting mine to proper XBOL 3 as soon as I get a chance. And it's part of TechLife 2009, so it should be ready to use. It plays well with the rest of LaTeX in that it's completely orthogonal to the rest of LaTeX. And you can write a package that uses this, and then you can load a normal package. It won't screw up the cat codes or anything, I promise. I've worked really hard on that. And when you're done loading the other packages, it will revert to whatever it should revert to. So it'll in summary, it'll do what you expect it to do. And yeah, that's about it.
Thank you.
Thanks. We do do have time for questions.
I don't have a question, but I do have a FYI, which is Joseph Wright did write a nice article about LaTeX 3. Some overlap, not completely overlapping for sure, different viewpoint, which will be in the tugboat, which is hopefully getting mailed right about now.
This was before he got on
the
team?
He wrote the article before he joined the team, and he finished the article after he got on the team.
I'm looking forward to seeing what he has to say.
Yeah, it's a very nice article. And I'm looking forward to your article as well.
So am I.
Thank you.
Okay.